Okay, so thank you. So I will start, it will take me some time to get to Vinberg's theorem, and I will start talking about the general reflections group. So take X to be the Euclidean plane, and I want that we look on two groups of isometries. The first group will be just the group which is generated by translation. So we have the map that takes x to x plus 1, 0. And we have the map that takes x to x plus 0, 1. And the second group will be the group that is generated by reflections. So we'll have R1, which is will be the reflection in the line x equals 0. We'll have R2, which is reflection in the line x equals 1. We'll have R3, which is reflection in the line ry equals 0. And we'll have the fourth reflection, y equals 1. So let's look at fundamental domains for these two groups. And if this is the point, let's say 0, 0, and this is the point 0, 0, then we have two fundamental domains that look the same. This is a fundamental domain, and this is a fundamental domain. So when we first look at this fundamental domain, they look exactly the same. But what I want to say is that, in fact, these two groups and the fundamental domains behave completely differently. So the first thing is, in this case, you have no uniqueness on the boundary. So you have the boundary of the fundamental domain. And you see that these points lies in the same orbit as these points. Whereas in the reflection group case, every orbit intersects the fundamental domain in a unique point, even on the boundary. So this is a very nice property. We have uniqueness not just in the interior, but
in other words, if you wanted a complete fundamental domain, you would take only two sides of that the first group, but all four sides are needed for the second group.
Yeah, but if I want to speak about closed fundamental domain to have nice properties, then a uniqueness also on the boundary. Yes. The second property, which is even more impressive, in this example, this is a fundamental domain, but we have many fundamental domains. For example, if you choose this thing, this is also a fundamental domain for this section. Whereas in the reflection group case, this is the unique fundamental domain that contains, for example, this interior point. We have no choice when we want to choose the fundamental domains. And the reason is very simple, because I have reflection with these lines, and since the reflection fixes every point on the lines, this point cannot be in the interior of the fundamental domain. So you have no choice but to put this line as the boundaries of your fundamental domain. So this is the unique fundamental domain, let's say, that contains the point FF, where here you have infinitely many different fundamental domains that contain this point. So the fundamental domain here is very rigid thing. So here you have unique fundamental. Of course, it's not unique, but you can always take a different square, but they are all the images of one another. But the uniqueness is if you choose a point in the interior, then you have a unique fundamental domain. Yes, connected, closed, all the nice properties. Unique fundamental domain that contains the points, let's say f. Whereas you have infinitely such fundamental domains. Now you can do the same discussion not only in Euclidean space but also in hyperbolic space. And mainly I will speak on hyperbolic space, but for this part of the talk I do not want to restrict myself because it costs me nothing. So x will always be either n-dimensional Euclidean space or n-dimensional hyperbolic space. And reflection is an isometry of order 2. Which pointwise fixes a hyperplane. So it's clear that the reflection is determined by the hyperplane, and then the hyperplane is determined by the reflection. So we have one to one correspondence between hyperplanes are in one to one correspondence to reflections. Hyperplane, I mean codimension one. So just a notation, if I'm given an hyperplane, then the corresponding reflection is denoted by SH. And if I'm given a reflection S, then the corresponding hyperplane is denoted by HS. Okay. So now I want to repeat what I said in this specific example in the general case. So let R be discrete a subgroup of isometries which is generated by reflections. So we'll denote by the set of hyperplanes are just to be the set of hyperplane where S is in R and this is a reflection. So we are not taking just the reflection in the generating set. We have to take all reflections that appears in our group. Okay, and what we'll do, we'll look at X minus the union of all the hyperplanes that corresponds to reflection in R. So this is an open subset of X, and it might have many connected components. So D will be a connected component. So it turns out that the closure of D is a fundamental domain. With all these nice properties, the uniqueness on the boundary, and if you choose a point in the interior, this is the unique fundamental domain that contains this point. Exactly from the same reason, there is no new idea in the general case. But we don't want to speak just about groups that are generated by reflection. So what about general groups of isometries? So gamma will be, let's say, just fuzzy generated. I don't really need it. A group of isometries. So I can always look at the set of reflection inside gamma, which is just the set of reflection inside gamma. And I defined edge gamma to be the corresponding set of hyperplanes. And finally, I take in the group which is generated by the reflection. So I don't know that there are any reflection, but if there aren't, then this is empty. This would be the trivial group, and this would be an empty set. So we can do exactly what we did in this case. We can look at x minus the union of the hyperplanes in H gamma. And now the thing that you have to notice is that the full group permutes this set. So the full groups permutes the connected components here. So actually, what you get that you always have a decomposition as a semi-direct product of gamma as R and as the stabilizer of D, where D is a connected component. And this is set-wise, okay? Set-wise stabilizer, not point-wise. It's preserve D as a set. So you always get such a decomposition, no matter for which group you just started. Maybe it's a trivial decomposition in the sense that R is trivial, possibly, but still the decomposition holds. Okay. So now I will start to restrict myself to hyperbolic planes because I want to get to state Vinberg theorem soon. So we know that we take the quadratic form fx equals x1 square plus x2 square until we get to xn square minus xn plus 1 square. And we can look at the set of points such that f of x is equal to minus 1. So the set of points consists of two connected components, two hyperboloids. And we know that if we choose one of them, we get a model to the hyperbolic plane. Where the metric is given by cosine hyperbolic of the distance between x and y is defined to be minus just the product of x and y. So if you have a quadratic form, you have the corresponding bilinear form. So this is just the corresponding, let's say, bilinear form. And this is how you define the metric. And it turns out that this is a model for the hyperbolic n space. Okay, but now you can look at the orthogonal group over R. And because it preserves the bilinear form, it's almost a group of isometries. The only problem can be that it might switches the two hyperboloids. So it has a subgroup of index 2, which fixes set-wise each one of these hyperboloids, so we denote this by O plus FR. And this is a group of isometries of the n-dimensional hyperbolic space. So we have a connection between the group of the orthogonal group of this quadratic form to the group of isometries of this hyperbolic space. Now, if Q is a general quadratic form, of signature N1, then we know that there exists a matrix GLNR, a GLN plus 1R, such that Q AX equal to FX. This is basically Sylvester theorem. So this tells me that for every k greater than zero, if I look at a connected component of this set, is still a model for the hyperbolic n-space. Just I'm using this correspondence, then I can define the metric and everything works. So in fact, so again, it has two connected components. I choose one of them, I get a model for hyperbolic n-space. But now, let's assume even further that Q is the integral quadratic form. So it will mean that it takes integral values, or if you know the difference between classical integral and integral, then you can assume that it's classically integral. This at this point makes no difference. Then we can speak about the group of integral matrices which preserve this form. So it turns out that this is a discrete group of isometries of projective space.
Plus Q?
Yes, thank you. So this is a discrete group of isometries of projective space. And then if it's a discrete group of isometries, we can do, I didn't say pattern generated, it's important discrete, otherwise it won't be true. Sorry, here everything I assume is discrete also. Okay, here I said discrete. And then if it's a discrete group of isometries, we have the decomposition is equal to the semi-direct product of its reflection group and the stabilizer of some connected component. So now I can state Vinberg's theorem of Vinberg from 72 that says that if n is greater than 30, it's probably a little bit less, but I don't remember the exact number. 30 is safe enough, probably 27 or 8 or something like that. Then the index of the reflection group is always infinite, no matter what is the quadratic form. So in particular, this is not a finitely generated group, this reflection group, but it gives you a normal thing subgroup. in the sense that it will be the risky dense, it will, and it will have infinite index. Okay. So in fact, I'm going to prove a slightly different theorem, in some sense weaker and in some sense stronger. So I'm going to prove the following theorem. So if n is greater, let's say, than a hundred, again, this is not tight, then the quotient contains an unabelian free subgroup. So of course it's infinite, but in fact it's much more than infinite. It's not, for example, it's not, it's an unamenable, and it's a very large group. Okay, so how do we prove this theorem? And the reason that I choose to prove this theorem and not the original theorem of Vinberg is that the proof is slightly more simple. Vinberg proofs uses the cusps, and it's slightly more complicated, the proof. Not by much. Okay. So the main ingredient in this proof is our Cartan involutions. So an isometry CV is called a Cartan involution with base for point V, if it fixes the point V and reverse geodesics passing, let's say, containing V. So what is the picture? You have the space, you have this point V, and you have a geodesic that contains it, then it reverses the geodesic. It acts like minus one on this geodesic. But not just on this geodesic, but on every geodesic that pass through this point. So for example, multiplication by minus one is a Cartan involution in Rn with respect to the base point zero. So what is the general strategy of the proof is as following. So we have a projective space, and we have the fundamental domain. So it has infinitely many sides. For the reflection group, so this is D. This is the fundamental domain for the reflection group. And assume that we can find here three points such this is V, bless you, this is U, and this is W, so that the corresponding Cartan involution, CV, CU, and CW, belongs to your group gamma, which is just O plus FQ, O plus QZ, and that V, U, and W not on the same line. Okay, so first of all, notice that this force CV, CU, and CW to be inside the stabilizer of D. Why? Because they fixes a point in the interior, so they must be in the stabilizer. So now all I have to do is I have to show to you that the group contains a free group. This is what I need to show. This contains a free group. Okay, so let's see what happens when I multiply two Cartan involutions. So I define TVU to be...
Were there any Cartan involutions?
So you have to prove it. It's not clear that you have Cartan involution. That's why we have some restriction of the on the dimension. Well, I will prove that there are, but later. So this, let's see what it takes. It takes, so this is first the geodesic that passed to them. It takes, I'm applying CU first, so it's take V here. But then I do Cartan involution in V, so it takes V to this point where if the distance here is D, and you do the computation, you see that V is maps to a point of distance 2D, and this is a general for every point, so this is a translation of distance to D, where D is the distance of U and V. But the same is true if I take now this thing, so I get a translation here. So let me, so this, I have a translation on this geodesic, and I have a translation on this geodesic. This geodesic has different, distinct endpoints because they intersect. So now what you do, if you take high enough powers, you see that you will play ping pong on projective space for high enough powers. So you'll get your free group. Because this is a translation here, this is a translation there. High enough powers will be translation with a very long translation length. So if it's large enough, you'll play ping pong and you'll get a free group. So for large enough M, TVU to them and TWU to them is isomorphic to the free group on two generated just by standard ping pong argument. So now our test is to show that indeed we have such three points, such three Cartan involution. Okay. So I will take Qx to be the even unimodular quadratic form of signature 41, 1. So this is a quadratic form with determinant minus 1. Its signature is 41, 1. And it's unique. What I mean unique, of course it's not unique, but you say the two quadratic forms are equivalent if you can transform from one to the other by change of coordinate. So it turns out that if under this restriction there is a unique equivalence class of such quadratic form, and I choose one a quadratic form in this class, and just I'm not going to use it, but such quadratic forms always have this signature. If you want, you have unimodular quadratic form of dimension 1 for every n, but if you want them to be even, and I thought I didn't set what it's even, even it means that it just gets even values. So for example, the norm of it does not get the value 3, you have to restrict yourself to this dimension. They only exist in this dimension. So I will do the proof in this case. So it's not just an example. In fact, this is a big step in the general proof to deal with this specific quadratic form. And then we can take as a model to the 41-dimensional hyperbolic space this model, and I choose one component, okay? So I choose a component. So how does integral reflection and integral Cartan involutions look like? So reflections are always of this form, x maps to x minus 2xv divided by vvv, where qv is equal to 2. And I denote by R2 the set of V and Zn with norm 2. So this is the general form of reflection in hyperbolic space. I will, in a second, I will draw the picture. But the requirement that QV, Z41, is equal to 2 is needed in order to make this a reflection integral. We don't care just about reflection. We want them that they will be integral. V and Z42. Thank you. We need that the value will be 2. And the picture is, so now this is V. It does not belong to any one of the hyperboloids because it has a positive norm. So the orthogonal thing to him intersect this hyperboloid and give you an hyperplane. So it fixes this hyperplane, and it's not the identity, so you see that it must be a reflection. So what are the Cartan involutions? So Cartan involution are, I will explain in a second, things of these forms. Where now, and if we want integral, then we need that the norm of V will be 2. And I will denote by C2 So let's see why this is true. So we will look at the geometric picture. So now I have a vector that does intersect, but the only problem that if without this minus, it is sent to its minus, so it switches the two hyperboloids, so it's not an isometry. So, but if I take minus, it fixes. Now, so it fixes this point, and it acts as minus one every no one else, that, so this is a Cartan involution.
Are you taking qv equal minus two?
Excuse me? Yes, sorry, thank you. It's now minus two. Thank you. Okay. Excuse me? So in the reflection case, the vector does not intersect the hyperboloids, but in this case it intersects, so it because it's sent to its inverse, it switches between the hyperboloids, and you have this inverse. No, sorry, I do not understand. This is the hyperboloid, a component
yeah,
of.
So should yeah, vector on it.
Oh, yeah, this is a vector that sits
it is.
Okay, on so this. Yeah, okay. So oh, so maybe, yeah.
But we're 42
dimensions
like
yeah,
that.
Okay. Now, if you have, let's take a vector of v such that its norm is minus 2. And we will look at its orthogonal complement, which is. So this thing is a subgroup of Z to the 42 of rank 41. And what you do, you can look at the quadratic form, but when it restricted to the orthogonal complement. So this is not really a quadratic form, because at least we think on quadratic form as polynomials. And here, you will get a polynomial once you will choose a base. But I have no canonical way to choose a base of this thing. So what you actually get, you get a map from C2 to equivalence classes of positive defined. Quadratic forms of determinant 2.
Wait, so maybe I'm just a little lost. So V perp restricted to Q is the quadratic form restricted to V perp?
Yes, but so and this maps V to just the equivalence class of Q when it's but in fact, so we have this map. So we have from CV to what is written there. And the map just send V to the equivalence class of the restriction of the quadratic form. But in fact, this factors to the orbits of O plus FZ on CV. Because it's clear that if you take two Cartan involution which are under the same orbit, you'll get here the same equivalence class of quadratic forms. But it turned out that this is it's an easy exercise that this is an onto map. So actually, you can get every even positive defined 41-dimensional quadratic form of discriminant 2 by this method. And you have to use the uniqueness of the, in order to show it, the uniqueness of the even unimodular quadratic form of signature 41.1. So now, what does it? So when V belongs to the, let's write it differently, when the orbit of V intersection with D was open, but I will write the interior just to make sure that we understand that we talk about the interior of the fundamental domain, it does not equal to zero. Exactly when this quadratic form does not represent two, because if it sits on a hyperplane, this means that you have a vector of norm and of an hyperplane that comes from its reflection. It means that you have here a vector of norm 2, which is orthogonal to it. If and only if does not represent 2. So this is the main thing that we are going to use. So for example, if I know that I have a quadratic form of discriminant, positive defined quadratic form of discriminant 2 that does not represent 2, I already know that I have at least one Cartan involution in the stabilizer of D. But we need three Cartan involution that do not sit on the same line. And then we have an easy lemma. If OV, OU, and OW are distinct, then, so this is the orbit, then VU and W are not on the same line. And the reason is very simple. If you have a line and you have Cartan involution with base points on this line, you choose the two base points which are closest to each other and possible, and then every other point you can move into this interval. But if they are closest to each other, then every other point maps to here or to here, and says Cartan posts, the only thing that determines them is their base point. You see that on a one geodesic you can that one geodesic can intersect at most two orbits. So putting all together, everything is now boils down to proving the following claim. There exist three non-equivalent even positive defined quadratic form. Of dimension 41 and determinant. So this now is a completely number theoretic question, and what you do, I don't have time to explain, but you use the mass formula to show that such three forms exist. And this finishes the proof of the special case. In order to pass from the special case to the general case, you need a little bit more geometry and a lot more theory of quadratic forms. To show that you cannot, but I don't have time to explain.